Hey friends, at long last, welcome back to Trig, and today I've got something very magical in store for you, and that is the mysterious topic of polar coordinates. Now, big things have small beginnings, and the humble origins of our story are in the Arctic, in the polar ice caps where we call home. Over here is our igloo. The mouth of the igloo is facing the positive x-axis. Here is our trusty fishing spot, and at this point over yonder lies a menacing polar bear, whom we have named Victor and whom we dare not disturb.
Victor?
Victor.
Why Victor?
Because he's a fancy polar bear.
Okay.
We feel he deserves a name. Victor, as a show of respect to him, as a show of honor.
A sign of victory. Maybe?
Yeah. Anyway, now let us suppose that each of these tick mark represents 1 mile, and I were to ask you, how should I get to my trusty fishing spot? How can I get there? Where is that point in space? Well, one thing you could say is just move on over, wander over 3 miles to the left.
That's the right.
So. That's the right. Okay, wander over 3 miles to the right, then wander up for 4 more, and voila, you are there. So that is dot, dot, dot. And we can encapsulate those directions very tersely as 3, 4. Like we're used to, and that is our x, y point. But now, is that the only way you could have given me directions, sir?
I don't think so.
I don't think so either. You could have just been like, look, the point is kind of northeast to us, is it not? Just wander out of your igloo, rotate a certain amount northwest. And after you rotate that certain amount northwest until you're facing the point, just walk in a straight line a certain amount until you reach that point, yes?
Yeah. So it's like an angled direction.
It is an angled direction. So I want to know, what are those certain amounts? What's the certain amount I need to rotate? What's the certain amount I need to walk in a straight line? Let's start from the top. How can I find the certain amount I need to rotate? Let's call this guy theta.
Well, it looks like we have a right triangle with those dotted lines.
You do. So that angle ends up being the inverse tangent of 4 over 3, yes?
Because 4 is the opposite and 3 is the adjacent.
Precisely, precisely. So the inverse tangent of 4 over 3 is?
Just punched it in my calculator and I got 53.13 degrees.
Approximately, yes. 53.13 degrees. Now with that out of the way, how much then do I need to walk in a straight line to reach my point?
Would it just be 5, right?
Well, yeah. We got a nice triangle. This is 3. This is 4. This whole thing is a square root of 3 squared plus 4 squared, which ends up being
5.
5, okay. So another way to specify this point, specify these directions, is 5, comma, 53.13 degrees. And instead of x, comma, y, this is our r and the theta. And those stand for our polar coordinates. Originally we had Cartesian coordinates, but now we are in the polar system where we have r and theta. How much do I rotate to face my point, and then how much do I need to walk in a straight line to get to that point? Cool?
Cool?
Cool, cool, cool. Now, what if I want to smother myself in sardine oil and walk on over to my good friend Victor, Mr. Polar Bear here, and give him a great big old hug? What would you say
to
me?
That's disgusting. Why would you do that?
That's besides the point. All I want to know is, how do I get there?
You'd move 4 to the left and 3 down.
4 to the left and 3 down. Da 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 da, da da da. Like so. So, how much should I rotate? It's going to be 180 degrees plus how much? How can I find that right there?
That theta.
That's going to be inverse tangent of?
Since you went 3 down and 4 to the left, it'd be 3 over 4.
Yeah. In absolute value terms, that is inverse tangent of 3/4. Now what is that, sir?
I got 36.87 degrees.
36.87 degrees approximately. And what is my distance?
Well, it'd also just be 5.
It would just be 5. Yeah. Just Pythagorate. So this point in polar coordinates, is 5, comma, 36.87 degrees. So, if I want to wander off to my fishies, you know, I just rotate 53.13 degrees and walk straight up 5 miles. If I want to wander on over to my good friend Mr. Victor, I rotate... Oh, that was a mistake. This should not be 36.87. Rather, it should be...
-36.87?
No, no, it's going to be this whole...
Oh, so it's 180 plus 36.87.
Yeah, 180 plus that.
So that'd be 216.87?
Yes, 216.87 degrees.
Gotcha.
Approximately.
Can we have negative degrees in the theta?
Sure. Theta can be positive, theta can be negative, theta can be anything. Now, let us generalize this whole process to get some nice handy-dandy formulas. So I got a point here in the first quadrant, but it can be any quadrant. And I'm like, look, now normally to get to a point, we go a certain amount left to right, go a certain amount up or down, and we label those our x and y, right?
Okay.
But with this new method, we're not doing left to right, up and down. We are doing angle rotations. How much do we need to rotate counterclockwise? Then how much should I walk in a straight line? That's my theta. That's my r. But in doing it, in drawing pictures for these two ways, what shape have I created?
You've created a triangle.
I've created a right triangle specifically, and with right triangles comes a variety of things. I can do the Pythagorean theorem to write this. I can also do trig stuff. For example, sine of theta is what?
Y over r.
Y over r. Cosine of theta is?
X over r.
X over r. So these give me two new formulas. I can say the y coordinate is always going to be r times sine of theta. And the x-coordinate's always going to be?
Y times cosine.
R cos. And I also know that, let's see here, that tangent of theta is always going to be what over what?
Y over x.
Y over x. And that is in perfect keeping, absolutely perfect keeping, with the with the plane trigonometry definition, always in keeping with the coordinate plane definition of tangent.
So would it be important to have those like pretty much remembered when dealing with polar
coordinates
and stuff?
Yes. These are your big four conversion equations.
Okay.
Now, I have shown you them in the first quadrant, but these are true in any quadrant. Whether it's you're in 2, 3, or 4, the y-coordinate's always going to be r times sine of theta, no matter what r is, no matter what theta is. The x-coordinate, likewise, always going to be r times cosine of theta. These are true in any quadrant.
Cool.
Any quadrant. So, your big four conversion equations, love them, love them, love them, love them well. But before we get into conversions, let us get some familiarity with plotting these points. So here we got a few points, this one, this one, and this one. Let's just go straight down the line. Here is 2 pi over 3, so remember, this is your r, that's your theta. So all I gotta do is first start with theta, rotate pi over 3 counterclockwise.
That's what, 60 degrees?
Yeah, but when you're just sketching a graph, you just need to go, hey, this is pi over 3.
Okay.
This is, just go out 2 in length. That's 2 pi over 3, and voila, you are done. Likewise, this one, which quadrant will I be if I plot this point?
Since it's negative, you'll rotate it clockwise, so that would be the 4th quadrant?
Yes.
Cool.
Yes, muchacho, that is a negative 45 degrees. Then I just simply walk out 3 in length, and I'm there.
So the r coordinate's always the length of the hypotenuse of this triangle we're making, right?
If you want to make a triangle, but it's just okay. The distance from the point to the origin.
Okay.
Now, what in tarnations do I do if my r value is negative? What sense can I make of a negative length? Now, for these, what I want you all to do is first plot the non-negative point. First, just plot 1, 3 pi over 4. What does that look like? Well, let me tell you. Or you can tell me. Where's 1, 3, pi over 4?
That's going to be in the first quadrant, right? No, it's going to be in the second
quadrant.
Rotating
3 pi over 4, so I'm about right there. So that is 1, 3 pi over 4. And then to account for this negative, all I have to do is take this point and rotate out 180 degrees, either clockwise or counterclockwise, so that I end up right there.
Okay.
So I could have gone clockwise, I could have rotated counterclockwise, but either way, this point here is how we define the negative r values.
Nice.
So that's negative 1, 3 pi root 4.
So negative 1 is like 1, but it's going in the other direction from the origin, basically.
Yeah, it's okay. Opposite this point. You can either think of it as rotating 180, or just think of it as, you know, just drawing it straight through the origin, kind of the flip of it.
Okay.
Makes sense?
Yeah.
Now, this next question. Find three equivalent coordinates for this point 3 pi over 3. This is just asking, how many different coordinate pairs will land me in the same spot as this point? So first, let's draw a picture. Where is this point?
I think we had it. It was in the first quadrant, right?
Yeah, it's going to be first quadrant. There's my 3, and there's my rotation of pi over 3. And there's the point.
Okay.
How many ways can I land in that spot? Tell me, what famous geometric movement, what famous geometric dance will land me in the same spot?
Well, since this moves in a circle...
The movement is a...
Circle.
It's a circle, yeah. Yes. So all I do, I just need to take my rotation amount and add what to it?
360 degrees or 2 pi radians.
Or 2 pi radians, I can add or subtract. The point is, it needs to be a circle.
Yeah.
So 1, I can write, well, it's just 3... pi over 3, let's say, plus 2 pi. Another one would be 3, let's say, pi over 3, minus 2 pi. That guy is what?
7 pi over 3?
7
yeah.
pi over 3. Whereas this one is?
Negative 5 pi over 3.
Yes. And I can keep doing that forever to get 3, 4, however many more, but there's one way I want to show you that makes use of not the positive r value, but a negative r value. So let us consider the point, if this is 3 pi over 3, then would you not agree that this right here is negative 3 pi over 3, yes?
Yeah.
Now if I start at this point, how can I get to that point? I wouldn't rotate 360 or 2 pi, but rather I would rotate how much?
180 would just pi.
Absolutely, muchacho, just 180, counterclockwise or clockwise. So, another point, besides these two, would be that point, let's say, plus pi radians, plus 180 degrees. Like so.
Nice.
And that builds up perfectly to our next question. Find all equivalent coordinates for that point. In other words, find every single way you can get to that point with a coordinate pair.
We'd have to use variables to talk about this, right?
Yeah, but I mean, variables are nice if they're nice. So, let me just take that point. 3, pi over 3, and now just add multiples of what?
2 pi.
Yeah, buddy! Multiples of 2 pi, multiples of full circles, let's say 2 pi n, where n is an integer. Any integer. And of course, the other way that deals with the other r value is to do what?
4 pi over 3 plus 2 pi n.
Yeah, buddy, so that is how you deal with those spicy boys. Now we've accounted for every possible way that we can get to that point in black. So that's how we deal with these spicy boys. Any questions?
No.
Cool. At long last, we are faced with the task of converting between polar and rectangular coordinates. In this case, we want to go from a point to a different point. A polar point to a Cartesian point.
Cartesian is like the plane that we've always used, right?
Yeah, Cartesian is your plain old X and Y, your plain old rectangle, your plain old left and right.
Okay.
Polar stuff is our fancy stuff.
Okay.
It's the new stuff. Now, here are our big four. Our big four conversion equations. You can see I've written them very neatly here.
That looks like a 13. That doesn't look like a B. Sorry.
Does that satisfy your soul?
Yes.
Okay, I'm glad to hear. That just makes my day. Oh, now then, where was I? Yes. On the right side, you can see I've put all my polar variables, my R's and my thetas. And on the left side is my Cartesian stuff, just X's and Y's. So that's why I wrote in this kind of weird offhand way. Anyway, all you gotta do for these, I wanna go from a polar point to a rectangular point, Cartesian point, is just plug and chuck. That's R theta, this one's also R theta. So then here, the X coordinate is
I times cosine of
yes, always r times cos, so always, in this case, 3
times cosine of 5 pi over 6.
Cosine of 5 pi over 6 is?
I don't know. Negative square root of 3.
Negative square root of 3 over 2.
Right.
So we get negative 3 root 3 all over 2 for our x coordinate. Mm-hmm. My y coordinate, r sine, which is
3 times sine of 5 pi over 6.
3 times sine of 5 pi over 6, which is 3 times
1 half.
1 half, which is?
Just 3 halves.
Just 3 halves. So this point
is negative 3 square root of 3 over 2, comma 3 over 2.
Yeah, I shouldn't say equals. But
they're not equal?
No, you don't want to express it like that. I mean, they get to the same point in space, but I can't just put equal to something.
Would you say they're congruent then?
No. They get you to the same point in space.
Okay.
Just leave it like.
Okay.
Now then here, same thing. And again, it does not matter whether this theta is positive or negative, you just plug and chuck. 2 cos negative 60. But cosine of the negative is the same thing as cosine of the
positive.
Positive. And cosine of 60 is?
I think just 1.
I don't know, it's 1 half. So it's 1. My y-coordinate is 2 times sine of negative 60. But now, in this case, sine of a negative number is the same thing as...
negative sine of that number.
Yeah. So that comes out to be...
negative 2 times square root of 3 over 2.
Cancel, cancel.
So negative square root of 3.
Negative square root of 3, and so our point in Cartesian plano rectangular coordinates...
is 1 and negative square root of 3.
Yep. And that is all, folks. That's how you convert from polar points to rectangular points.
Okay.
So now you all, we want to go the other way. We want to convert these following points and rectangular coordinates to polar coordinates, and we want to be specific and find the theta that's in between 0 and 2 pi. It's not just any theta, but just the theta is in between those two values. Again, these are x and y. X, y. And I want to get to an r comma theta value. Well, if I know my x's and y's, what equation leaps out at you?
The first one.
The very first one. I can immediately find my r for each one. I know that r squared in this case, well, in general, it's x squared plus y squared. But for this first point, that boils down to negative 1 the whole thing squared plus 1 the whole thing squared, which comes out to be 1 plus 1, which is 2. That is r squared. So r very simply is...
Square root of 2.
Square root of 2. Now, for these, unlike the rest, I don't want you to think of it as just simple plug and chug. After you find your r, jump into a picture. Plot this point on your coordinate plane. So in this case, negative 1. Positive 1. There's my point. So draw the point. Step 1. Connect it to the origin. Step 2. And then draw the angle, counterclockwise angle, step 3.
So you draw the angle from the first origin over the y-axis, right?
What was that?
You draw the angle theta starting from 0 on the x-axis, right?
Right, because I'm trying to find an angle between 0 and 2 pi, which means it's positive, which means I have to do counterclockwise rotation. But either way, whether you're doing counterclockwise or counterclockwise, you're always rotating starting from the positive x-axis.
Okay.
So that's my theta. You can also draw on your r if you want. That's root 2. And now then, I want you to, with that point, do what we have been doing, just form a nice, simple right triangle. But then take that right triangle out of the coordinate plane. Don't worry about positives and negatives for a second. So that's the length of one absolute value, that is also one. So again, no, just plain geometry triangle, 1, 1, root 2. What is this angle right here in radians?
It's 45 degrees, but radians would be pi over 4.
Yeah, I care about radians given that. So yeah. That is pi over 4. So right here is pi over 4. So what is my theta?
That would be 3 pi over 4.
Right. The whole thing, rotation to the negative x-axis is a pi radians. I know this is pi over 4. So that is 180 pi minus 45, or pi over 4, which is 3 pi over 4. So all in all, my point in polar coordinates are theta is root 2, comma,
3 pi over 4.
3 pi over 4. That's all you do for that. Now, next one. Again, it doesn't matter that we're not going to have a right triangle here. Even though this y is 0, we can still apply this equation. So I know that r squared is negative 3 the whole thing squared plus 0 the whole thing squared. So what does my r come out to be?
Just 3.
Plain old 3, which makes sense. Now, just like I did before, I'm going to plot this point. There's my negative 3. There's my 0. If you want, you can draw a little segment as so. But then after I draw the segment, I do what? Final thing is to draw the...
Draw the theta.
Yes, and again, it's from the positive x-axis. In this case, counterclockwise. Now for this one, I don't need to do any fancy right triangle stuff. I can just look and see that this theta is...
Pi over 2. Or pi. Pi, sorry.
Just 180, just plain pi radians. And with that, our theta is 3 comma pi.
Negative, 3, oh yeah, 3 comma pi.
Just 3 comma pi.
Okay.
All right, cool.
Yeah, I have a quick question though.
Shoot.
Could it also be negative 3, 0 for r?
Yeah, that could work as well.
Okay.
That could work as well. But I just want one point, so...
Gotcha.
That's so we are on to the big boy conversion questions, which is going from polar equations to rectangular equations. I'm rectangular equations to polar equations. So we'll start with the first type. I want to go from a rectangular equation to a polar equation that expresses r in terms of theta. In other words, you want to solve for r in terms of theta. Get r on one side, everything else on the other. Aye. So here we got a nice simple x plus y equals a number. But I don't want x's and y's, I want r's and thetas. So I had to erase the stuff from the board to make room for me to gallop, but remind me, what are my four big conversion equations?
Well, you got x squared plus y squared equals
r squared. The x coordinate's always...
r times cos of theta.
R cos, the y coordinate's always...
r sine.
R sine, and tangent of theta's always...
y over x?
Yes, yeah. Absolutely, always y over x. But out of those four, which two would be the quickest in immediately eliminating x and y?
The middle two, x being r cosine theta and y being r sine theta.
Precisely, muchacho, x is r cos, y is r sine. So do a little subby sub and you get
R cos theta plus r sine
plus r sine equals 5. Cool. Algebra of the left side.
You can factor out an i.
Yes, because again, I want to solve for r in terms of theta, so I need r on one side. R times cos plus sine equals 5. And so all in all, r is 5 divided by sine theta plus cos theta. Ay, 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 that's a weird thing, right? We're dividing by a sine plus a cosine.
And that's supposed to yield like an equation, like x plus y equals 5.
Yeah, that's supposed to be the same thing as x plus y equals 5. And it's true, but this looks quite funky. By the way, what does this graph look like?
Well, that's just y equals negative x plus 5.
Negative x plus 5, which of course is a nice, straight, what?
It's a line going from 05 to 50.
Kind of like that, yes?
Yeah.
So that's pretty cool. I mean, even though this thing looks pretty daggone funky, right?
Mm-hmm.
Still, when you graph this, it's going to be a straight line. This and this generate the same graph, which of course they have to, because each coordinate has the same spot. Now, let's move on to another. Ooh. Now for this, you may be tempted to just plug in x equals r cos and y equals r sine, but I want you to hold your daggone horses and do a bit of algebra with this guy before you start plugging and chugging. Let me get rid of these parentheses. That's x squared minus 2x plus 1 plus y squared equals 1. What do I have on both sides?
You have a... on both sides.
On both sides.
You have a 1.
I have 1, so I get minus 1, minus 1. Get rid of those.
Okay.
So I get x squared minus 2x plus y squared equals 0. And now I can put the x squared and the y squared right next to each other. So it's x squared plus y squared minus 2x. Now, any idea why I sandwiched the x squared and the y squared together like this?
Because that's just r squared.
Fall back on your big four conversions and notice that x squared plus y squared is always...
r squared.
R squared and x is always...
r cos theta.
The x coordinate is always r cos. And now we get something quite nice. We get r squared minus r, minus 2r cos is 0. So r squared is always 2r cos for this problem. I can do something further to simplify this.
Divide both sides by r?
Yeah. Divide by 1r to get just 1r on the left and no r's on the right. So r, 1r is 2 times cos, and that is it. This very crisp equation encapsulates the same information as this relatively unwieldy expression. Now, if I were to go further and say, oh, graph this guy, well, you can start with the rectangular equation, right? Mm-hmm. What is the graph of this?
It's going to be a circle, right?
Yes. As you all know from pre-calculus and foundations, this is the graph of a circle. The center is at...
1, 0.
1, 0, and the radius is?
1.
1. So, like so. Both of these, this thing and this thing, is the graph of a circle. Okay. So, it might seem weird, but if it's 2 times cosine, that 2 represents the diameter of the circle. And the cosine just comes from the fact that when we did this stuff here, it was the y's that went away and the x remained, so that became cosine there.
Okay.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right. Final stretch is converting polar equations to rectangular equations. And for these, you don't need to solve for y in terms of x. You just want x's and y's equaling some other stuff in numbers, or it could be x's and y's as well. Let's start from the top. Here's a polar equation, nice simple r equals 5, but I don't want r, I want just x's and y's. What's the simplest equation relating r's, x's, and y's?
X squared plus y squared equals r squared.
Right, all the time, x squared plus y squared is r squared. So x squared plus y squared in this case equals?
25.
25. What is the graph of this?
It's a circle with a radius of 5.
Right. Nice circle with a radius of 5. And this is why, by the way, we've been labeling the distance from the origin to the point in polar coordinates as r. Clearly, you can see here, this is just, hey, it's a circle centered at the origin of radius 5. That's all there is to that. Now, again, for part B, I have a theta equals pi root 4. The name of the game is to do some stuff to both left and right side so that you get something that matches something in your conversion formulas. Now, in your conversion formulas, where do you see theta? See it in equation 2, you see it in equation 3.
And equation 4.
It's equation 4, but which of those has something just in terms of rectangular stuff on one side?
That'd be the last one. Tan is y over x.
Right. Tan is y over x, so in this case, all I gotta do to get to match an equation is just tan both sides. Now, so I don't have to deal with any pesky r's. I had x equals r cos, y equals r sine, but tan is just a very simple y over x. There's no pesky r lurking around in there. Mm-hmm. So if I tan both sides, I get tan theta equals tan of pi root 4. Someone remind me, what is tan of pi root 4?
That is just 1.
Nice simple 1, and we know from our nice conversion formulas that tangent of theta is y over...
x.
Y over x. So this whole equation.
It's just y equals x, okay.
Yeah, multiply both sides by x. Okay, y equals x. Now someone help me out. What is the graph of y equals x?
Straight line through the origin.
A nice straight line through the origin, and that's all this polar graph is. The graph of theta equals pi over 4 is this nice straight line through the origin. Where does the pi over 4 come into play visually? Well, that's just the angle right there. That is a nice 45 degrees. That's a nice pi over 4 radian.
So every x value corresponds with every y value.
Yes.
Okay, cool.
They're equal. Now then, this one here, part C. I want you to pause the video and try this one on your own, and we'll get back to it in a minute. So what'd you do for this?
Let's see.
Again, before you start plugging in equations, for this one it helps to do a bit of algebra.
Yes.
Fall back on a bit of algebraic jiu-jitsu. 3 times cosecant is 3 divided by what?
Sine.
3 divided by sine. So just 3 by itself, I get by multiplying both sides by?
Sine of theta, r times sine of theta.
Yes. I know r times sine of theta.
That's just y.
It's always the y coordinate. So I get y equals 3 and I am done. No good, sir. What is the graph of y equals 3?
Horizontal line.
Nice horizontal line. Going through the y-axis at 3. So again, appreciate how funky this original thing looks. You know, r equals 3 times cosecant of theta. It turns out the graph of this thing is just a simple straight line.
Cool.
Cutting through the y-axis at 3. Ooh. A final equation here. Final boss. R equals negative 6 cos.
Okay.
Okay, the name of the game is to multiply both sides by something so that it matches something in your conversion formulas. I'm going to go ahead and write down the conversion formulas again. So I had r squared being x squared plus y squared. I had r cos being the x coordinate, r sine being the y coordinate, and tangent of theta always being
y over x.
Y over x. Again, my nice big four conversion equations. So do you see a plain old r anywhere by itself on the left sides?
In the first equation?
Just one plain old r. Do you see one, just one plain old r on this left side, this left side, this left side, or this left side?
No.
But what's the closest thing you see to it?
An r squared.
An r squared. So how about I multiply both sides by r of this? So that at least on the left side I get r squared, which does match something I have in that big old box. So r squared is negative 6.
Oh, nice. And the right matches, too.
What on the right matches?
Like the right side, negative 6 r cos, that's also just negative 6x.
Right. Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Look at that. I'd be darned. R cos appears here, and that's always x. R squared is always x squared plus y squared. And so what do we have here?
X squared plus y squared equals negative 6x.
Equals negative 6x. I can bring that negative 6x on over to the left side. I can get x squared plus 6x. Plus y squared equals 0. By the way, you can stop here if you want. And that's fine. I mean, this is fine too. Both of these answer the question perfectly fine. But if you want to graph this thing, one way to do it anyway is to go a step further and say this is the same thing as x plus 3, the whole thing squared, plus y squared equals what?
9?
Yes, this is x squared plus 6x plus 9. When you complete the square, if I have a plus 9 on the left, I need a plus 9 on the right.
Okay, so that's a circle.
A nice circle centered at what point?
Negative 3, 0.
Negative 3, 0, and what's the radius?
3.
Right, so it hits the origin and does a little number like so. That's more egg-shaped, but you get the meaning. I hope that is a nice circle.
Cool.
So, that is how you, that's one way to graph these things.
Yep.
And that is my very terse intro to polar coordinates, where we touch a little bit on the graphs.
Nice.
Questions, comments?
What's the point of all of this?
The point of all this? Some graphs are far more easily expressible in terms of polar coordinates than rectangular coordinates.
Okay.
For example, we're going to look a little bit and graph a nice petal graphs like this. stuff like that. That's a very hard thing to express in terms of x's, just x's and y's. But with r's and thetas, that's actually a very simple thing to express.
Okay, cool.
And in calculus, we'll do it with polar coordinates as well. And it's a lot of fun. You can have a polar that you can't have with rectangular.
Nice.
With rectangular stuff.
Cool. Okay.
Can I hear her?